Hey everyone, and welcome to the brand new video series on this channel, Oneironaut or Oneironot. It's a working title, I quite like it though, it's a bit cheesy, I don't care. This is the show in which we take a character from fiction to analyse their character, analyse their strengths and weaknesses, to determine that if this character was real, would they make a good lucid dreamer? Would they be an Oneironaut? Or are they just Oneironot? It is ridiculous when I say it out loud. Today we're taking the character of Sherlock Holmes for the maiden voyage of this channel series. However, before we start to analyse the character, there are a few ground rules that I want to cover just so that we are all on the same page. Firstly, lucid dreaming. The definition of a lucid dream is that you are aware that you are dreaming whilst you are in a dream. This means any layer of control, whether you have full control of a dream or whether you just know. As long as you know, you are having a lucid dream. Secondly, if I'm taking a character for analysis, I'm not going to pick the obscure continuations of a character or obscure different genres of the character. I'll be taking the most commonly used one. For example, if there's a character from a TV show whose story continues through comic books, like Angel or Buffy, then I will just use the TV show as a reference. And third, very important, that dreams are not linked to astral projection. I won't go into detail as to why or show you any evidence, but it's important to understand that the direction of this video series is that I'm going to use lucid dreaming from a scientific point of view, and that we dream entirely in the brain. And that's the way I'm going to approach these videos. And finally, character specific. There have been many different iterations of Sherlock Holmes throughout history, from the books to different various TV shows.
That's how you deduce, baby! I read your face! I read your stupid face! Yeah!
And I'm going to use Benedict Cumberbatch's version for the character analysis. This way it will be easy to understand, easy to digest, and that would not spread over too many different adaptations. So without further ado, let's get straight into the video.
Let's just jump into it.
Number one, his epic brain. There are many different qualities that attribute to somebody's success in the field of lucid dreaming, and I believe that Sherlock Holmes possesses pretty much all of them, starting with his brain. He has very keen observational skills. And this is really important for lucid dreaming. Sherlock is a grand master in something known as inductive reasoning. He is able to observe a ton of information all at the same time and whittle down the irrelevancies until he has formulated a probable solution. Meaning that if something feels off, chances are he will figure it out. Notice how Sherlock bumped into this couple, and through rapid mental gymnastics, he was able to determine that they were indeed German. So he spoke to them in German. Entschuldigen Sie bitte. The best quote I've ever found on inductive reasoning is this one. When I've eliminated the impossible, whatever remains, no matter how mad it might seem, must be the truth. Does that sound familiar? Obviously, this is a great skill to have as a lucid dreamer. The reason being is that you can observe the outside world all around you until you whittle down the irrelevancies or the things that stick out, and you come to a probable solution that you are either awake or you are in a dream. And once you've concluded that you are in a dream, no matter how mad it sounds, that must be the truth. And because Sherlock Holmes also has this opinion very deeply embedded into his system, he is able to go with that decision wholeheartedly. However, Sherlock's own personality is a bad point when it comes to his skill level of lucid dreaming. He's too cocky with his own inductive reasoning. There was a time in the show in which his arch nemesis Moriarty was standing right in front of him. Moriarty dressed and acted differently to throw Sherlock Holmes off the scent and make him believe that he was a gay man.
What do you mean gay?
The thing is, Moriarty knew the process that Sherlock uses to solve problems, and he also understood the character of Sherlock being cocky in his own decision making. Sherlock knows he's brilliant.
Are you seriously claiming this man is an expert? After knowing the accused for just 5 minutes?
2 minutes would have made me an expert. 5 was ample.
So he was able to use that information against Sherlock to trick him, providing a blanket of anonymity. Sherlock's own cockiness in his ability to solve a problem is what got him in that sticky situation. He was so sure of himself that he overlooked the obvious truths. If he'd have taken a moment to slow down and really think about what was going on, he may have figured out that this gay man in front of him was in fact Moriarty, the person that he was trying to catch. This can be very difficult for a lucid dreamer, because in a dream, we are often left with a solution to the problem of am I dreaming, which doesn't sound quite right. If you do a reality check and it comes out as a negative negative, you might conclude that you are in a waking life situation. However, you're not. And if you take time to slow down and look at your decisions and look and observe the world around you, you might have that inclination that you are actually in a dream. It's happened to me tons of times in the past, and I'm sure it's happened to some of you as well. Sometimes in dreams, we can forget that we're actually dreaming and we continue down the path. And because of a dream's ability to cloud your judgment, it can make solving problems very difficult. Admittedly, Sherlock's own cloudy judgment is probably far superior to my heightened judgment when I'm on the most powerful drug from Limitless. It's probably still better than mine. But nevertheless, we are not performing at optimum peak, like, judgment calls when we're in dreams, so that could cloud his judgment, and because of his cockiness, it can skew the information that he has learnt from inductive reasoning. Sometimes when we're dreaming, the dream will try and convince us otherwise. Sometimes in the form of a plot point, sometimes a character will actually just tell us that we're not dreaming. And if Sherlock Holmes is as intelligent as I think he is, then his own subconscious mind must be just as intelligent, if not even more intelligent. So his own mind might know ways to trick his own mind, so that he can fool himself to believing that he is awake when he is in a dream. For lucid dreaming, you need to be rational, observant, less cocky, and more open-minded. And Sherlock Holmes can struggle with some of those. Number two, drugs. When we drink alcohol, our brain does not go into REM effectively. And REM is the stage of sleep in which dreaming is most likely to occur. So if we take alcohol, for example, and we drink it, because we're not going into REM, we're having a very reduced amount of dream time. And you can suss this out for yourself, because when you drink alcohol and you wake up, you feel awful. It's because you haven't had the restorative process of REM, plus you're dehydrated, plus you've still got alcohol in your system. But a portion of that has to do with REM. Now, Sherlock doesn't drink alcohol, apart from John's bachelor party, in which he scientifically calculated how much alcohol would make them absolutely trolleyed. But he has a different problem. He's been known in the show to take two different types of drugs, one of them being cocaine and the other being some form of opiate, like heroin, although it's not directly stated, I don't think. Cocaine is a party drug. When you take it, it leaves you feeling very wired, very energetic, very, like, manic. But on the flip side of that, consistent use of cocaine can lead to insomnia, and I don't think I really need to say much more than that. Insomnia is the exact opposite of what we want for a lucid dreamer. Although Sherlock has stated in the show that he takes the drug to help him think. It makes him fire off his neurons in his brain more effectively so that he can solve problems that no one else can solve. But it also has the added side effect of not sleeping. And then we have the other drug, which is an opiate. Although heroin and other drugs similar to heroin can make the user go into a state that very closely resembles sleeping, it's not. Opiates actually block the brain's ability to be able to go into REM, and to some extent, partially non-REM as well. Meaning that even if you look like you're asleep, you're not actually in REM, and you're not really in non-REM either. So you're technically sort of unconscious. If Sherlock were to be a lucid dreamer, he would have to quit the non-governmental sanctioned drugs immediately, which would be difficult for him as he is an addict. A full-blown addict. Number three, no sleep. I've already said in this video that sleep is very important for lucid dreaming, and Sherlock isn't known for his regular sleeping patterns. In the books, and I know I'm not analysing the book character, but this just portrays the point that I have quite closely, is that when he's on a case day, it's stated that he stops sleeping. Everything he does is for the case. Sleep is optional. Sleep is optional. Those three last words send shiver down my spine as a coach of lucid dreaming. Even when he's not on a case, he has been known to get agitated and start thinking about cocaine, which can lead to more sleep issues. I'd say if you're a beginner at lucid dreaming, you need to have roughly 8 hours sleep a night. A bare minimum would be 6 hours. And this is because of the length of REM. It gets progressively longer during the night, so that as you are approaching the 7 or 8 hour mark, your dreams are anywhere between half an hour long, but your first sleep cycle, your dreams are about 5 minutes. So you can see the importance of sleeping longer, and if Sherlock Holmes doesn't sleep that much, well, he's not getting the best out of his powers. Powers. Like he's Spider-Man or something. Number 4, Mind Palace. Sherlock has something very unique. He has a place in his mind in which he stores lots of information. There are other people in the world who have a very similar form of Mind Palace. There's Ben from the Super Carlin Brothers, who has a table, a desk, and pieces of paper and drawers and stuff have different pieces of information. Love the Super Carlin Brothers, by the way, if you're watching this. Yo, what's up? Pretend I played that a little bit cooler. Darren Brown is a mentalist, and in one of his books, he talks about his processes of learning big pieces of information. He has a house in his mind in which each room has a different function. For example, in one room is where he uses his information to count cards. Sherlock also has a system for remembering things, but unlike Darren Brown's house or Ben's desk, his is a palace. This gives you an indication to the sheer power of his mental capacity. If in his mind he is able to remember pieces of information and eject them at will to his knowledge base in his mind. Memory and lucid dreaming go hand in hand. It's something that I don't really talk about on the channel, but when you break it down, it becomes quite obvious. There's something called prospective memory, which is your ability to remember to perform a planned action. Lucid dreaming uses two main types of prospective memory, one of which is time-based, for example, oh, it's 6 o'clock, I need to do this thing, or event-based, where you see a cue and then you perform a planned action. In lucid dreaming terms, if you see the clock strikes 12, you go, oh, it's 12, I should do a reality check. Or if you see a dream sign, that's your cue, and then you need to use your prospective memory to perform the action. Now, there's not much evidence in the show to say that he would be good at prospective memory. However, he has got a fantastic memory, and I'm assuming that some of this memory ability is a transferable skill in some capacity. So it wouldn't be out of the question to assume that he would have an excellent ability of prospective memory, making dream signs and dream recall very, very easy for him. In conclusion, Oneironaut or Oneironot? Would Sherlock Holmes make a good lucid dreamer if he were real? Now, Sherlock Holmes has two things going for him. Number one is his very good skill at observation, and number two is his epic memory. These two things would make any lucid dreamer incredibly jealous, and this would 100% put him in a Oneironaut and not an Oneironot. I believe that he would be able to take the time to analyze a situation effectively because of his observational skills and because of his sure-hearted way in which he is very certain of his judgment, then I think that he would make a really good lucid dreamer. However, his habits are very poisonous to any lucid dreamer. The ability to go into REM is key for a lucid dreamer to be able to function. His drug abuse and his disregard for the importance of sleep is awful. So, what will it be? Oneironaut or Oneironot? This may shock you. I'm going to say Oneironaut. He has epic potential, however, he is not a good case study for someone trying to learn how to lucid dream. The stuff that he can do with his mind is only second nature. A lot of what makes lucid dreaming very good is the habits that you build. If you can build a good habit, like going to sleep regularly, building a habit to have prospective memory to a time, you can bypass your excellent memory skills and your observational skills and just whittle down to being habitual in your process of lucid dreaming. If he's not on a case, he thinks about drugs. If he's on a case, he takes drugs. And he doesn't sleep either way, so he wouldn't make a good lucid dreamer. But how do we fix this? If Sherlock Holmes was one of my clients, how would I fix his ability to lucid dream? Well, I would say to him about the importance of sleeping and that it actually improves cognitive functioning, so he would need to have at least 8 hours sleep a night. He would also have to stop taking the drugs that inhibit his ability to be able to sleep effectively. However, with that said, he does have one of the best personality traits and types for a lucid dreamer. Someone who thinks outside the box, someone who is a bit more observant about the world around him, and someone who's basically a Ravenclaw. If you think outside the box, you're pretty good. And he only needs to make a few changes in order to... I'm talking like he's a real character. He only needs to make a few changes in order to be very good at lucid dreaming. However, these changes are massive. Drug abuse, drug addiction, it's difficult to get rid of. I'm addicted to sugar and I can't stop, and that's sugar. So that's it for the first Oneironaut or Oneironot. Please let me know if you enjoyed this video and this series. If you want to see your favorite character from fiction get analyzed by me, then post in the comment section below, who do you want to see next on this show? If you'd like to learn how to lucid dream, then check out my channel below. If you want some private tutelage, then go over to patreon.com/GizEdwards and have a look at the student tier. Student places are limited, so be quick. I want to say a big thank you to all the Patreon supporters and the channel members too. Without your support, I would be broke. Also, if you're a $4 or more Patreon supporter, you get to see this and other videos on my channel a few days before they get posted on YouTube. So for those of you who are just subscribers on the channel, I want to say, see you next Saturday.